Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Great, thank you. All right, so what is hospital-acquired infection? Cross-infection of one patient by another or by doctors, nurses, and other staff while the person is in hospital. Okay, so that is the definition of hospital-acquired infection. Now, hospital-acquired infection is a good indicator. High frequency is evidence of poor quality of health service delivery. So if any hospital needs to adhere to standards, an important indicator is the rate of hospital-acquired infections in that facility. So if you want to see the quality of hospitals or health centers, it's good to know what is the rate of infection that occurs at that place. And therefore, it is mandatory that every healthcare setting has an infection control committee, which monitors this aspect. Now, why do hospitals are a place where people come to heal? Okay. And so why is this particular area becoming a focus of infection? So there are many contributing factors, and one of the most important thing is that in hospitals, the people who are hospitalized, many of them are immunocompromised. And because they're immunocompromised, they are more susceptible to other infections. Okay. Then patients who are admitted also undergo a lot of invasive examinations, okay, as well as treatment. You know, IV lines are inserted, CVP lines are put in, especially if the person is severe. So these can all act as tracks of infection. Okay, that is why ICUs, intensive care units, are another place in which infections can be transmitted to patients, which they did not have. Okay, patient care practices are changing. Hospital environment, okay, can facilitate transmission of microorganisms. The way we clean the hospital setting, the AC which is installed, okay, the air conditioning system which is installed, that can also act as a conduit for microorganisms. Okay, so it's important that when cleaning is carried out, okay, that it is wet wiping and wet cleaning so that you're not raising a cloud of organisms. Okay? Also, there is a selective pressure of intense antibiotic use in a hospital care setting, which promotes antibiotic resistance. There are also changes in medical practices, which present new opportunities for the development of infection. So we see how hospital can act as a locus of patients acquiring other infections from that which they are already suffering from. So what is the definition of hospital acquired infection? These are infections which occur among persons who are admitted more than 48 hours after admission. Now, why this criteria of 48 hours? Because they may also be incubating some disease, okay? So therefore, we do not immediately say that this is hospital acquired. At least some time lapse has to elapse before we can say that this person has contracted an infection because of the hospital setting. So if you look at the different types of hospital acquired infections, there are criteria to identify these infections. So for a surgical site infection, it is defined as any purulent discharge or an abscess or spreading cellulitis at the surgical site, okay? So where you've taken incision, okay, where surgery has been carried out, okay? At the surgical site during the month after the operation. Urinary tract infection, this is another very common in hospital acquired infection. So if there is a positive urine culture, one or two species, which at least 10 raised to 5 bacteria per ml, with or without clinical symptoms. So if you can prove on culture that there are organisms, so that is demonstration of a acquired urinary infection. Then another common route of infection is the respiratory tract infections. So if the person develops respiratory symptoms with at least two of the following signs which appear during hospitalization, okay? So at hospitalization, they were not there, but during hospitalization, the person develops cough, develops purulent sputum, or if you can see a new infiltrate on chest x-ray, that is demonstration or criteria for respiratory tract infection. Provascular catheter infection, if there is inflammation, lymphangitis, or purulent discharge at the insertion site of the catheter, that would constitute a vascular catheter infection. If the person develops fever or rigors and at least one positive blood culture, then we can say that the person has developed septicemia following admission. So hospital-acquired infections is the new terminology which is preferred. The previous term that was used was called as nosocomial infections. Okay, now nosocomial infections, we prefer to use hospital-acquired infections because we understand that not just patients, but even people who work in hospital settings can acquire infections, and visitors can also, and therefore the restrictions on the age. We do not like young children to visit hospital settings too often. Therefore, the change from nosocomial infection to hospital-acquired infection. Now, this can occur both in endemic as well as epidemic form. If the hospital quality care is not good enough, then it can be endemic. It can occur among many of the patients who are at the hospital, or it could occur during a particular time. So it can occur both as endemic as well as epidemic form. Now, endemic infections are usually more common in healthcare settings, and these can encompass infections which occur in any healthcare setting. So it's not just based, though the term suggests hospital, it can be a clinic, it can be a primary health center, a community health center, okay, tertiary level institution, or an individual health caregiver. Okay, so it includes all of the healthcare settings. It also includes infections which are acquired by staff or visitors. Okay, so not just patients are getting infected, but the health caregivers getting infected, or persons who are visiting the patients also can get. Now, this was an interesting study which was carried out. This is a French national prevalence survey and carried out a long time ago, as you can see, 1996. But this holds true even today. Okay, so the findings of this survey are pretty similar to what we see today as well. Okay, so as you can see from this pie chart, your majority of the pie is hogged by urinary tract infections. So urinary tract infections are one of the most common hospital-acquired infections, followed by lower respiratory tract infections, pneumonias, then surgical site, soft skin and tissue, soft tissue, as well as other respiratory tract infections, followed by eye infections, ear infections, catheter site infections, and other sites. Okay, so this pattern is seen even now. So what are the other nosocomial infections? Okay, so skin and soft tissue infections like open sores, so persons especially who cannot move, okay, patients with who have paralysis, okay, hemiplegia, those who cannot move or turn around very much, and because of constantly lying on beds, they can develop sores. So when these sores open, okay, so you can have ulcers, you can have bed burns because of bed sores. Okay, these are the sites which encourage bacterial colonization. So this is also, so it's important, nursing care is very important at this time, frequent turning, okay, for even for patients with burns to see that they are under a tent. Okay, the blisters, especially with burns, should not be burst because the fluid inside the blister is sterile. The minute it bursts, there's a chance of infection coming in. Okay, so care, especially persons who have extensive burns, they should be taken care of. Okay, so skin and soft tissue infections. Gastroenteritis is another common nosocomial infection among children, and rotavirus is a chief pathogen. Clostridium difficile is the major cause of nosocomial gastroenteritis in adults in developed countries. So when we use the word nosocomial, remember that we are talking about patients. Okay, so sinusitis and other enteric infections, infections of the eye and conjunctiva, and sometimes following childbirth, women can develop endometritis and other infections of the reproductive tract. So what is the source of hospital-acquired infections? So your main focus so hospital is the locus, and the focus of infection is, or the reservoir of infection, are patients who suffer from infectious disease. Okay, so all of the spectrum of infectious disease, viral, bacterial, protozoal, parasitic infections, persons who suffer from skin infections, especially more so those who have respiratory infections, because the rate of transmission is faster, and those with urinary tract infections. Okay, so those who are coming with primarily these problems, they are the ones who act as a focus of infection to the others. Now, staff, which includes doctors, nurses, ward attendants, who come in close contact with patients, are also an important source. Okay, so patients are the first important source. Doctors and health caregivers are the next source. So this is because of common cells. Okay, for example, we carry staph aureus in nose or on skin. There are people who are carriers. You can also have people also have hemolytic streptococci in their throat, and because also of the bacteria in the gut. Okay, so Salmonella and E. coli in the gut. The hospital environment is laden with microorganisms and is an important source. So what are the sources of in the hospital environment? So it is the hospital dust, the hospital linen, the linen which is used, okay, so what is put, the clothes which are given to the patients, then the also what is put on the beds and the pillow covers. Okay, this is all act. So clothing of patients, clothing on the hospital bed can also act as infection. Also the furniture. Okay, so dust settles on furniture, on sinks, basins, door handles. Okay, the hospital air, all of this can act as the source of infection. Now if you look, this is a graphical representation of the various organisms which cause which are the nosocomial pathogens. Okay, so in the 20th century, as you can see, in the early 19th, in the 20th century, it was mainly streptococci, followed by staph. Okay, and after that, around the 60s was when we began finding infections being caused by gram-negative rods. Then you can see from the 80s onwards, we have a whole lot of organisms which have come up. Okay, and this is because of all of your resistant organisms. Okay, so the antimicrobial resistant microorganisms, which is increased occurrence of organisms which do not respond to your conventional list of antibiotics, and therefore you need stronger, and therefore we have now our first generation, after first you have second, third, and fourth generation, okay, of antibiotics. And as we had seen even in the last class where we looked at emerging infections, we had seen that it is these antimicrobial resistant organisms which are causing a public health challenge. So these are your methicillin resistant staph aureus, vancomycin resistant enterococci, your ESBL organisms, okay, like E. coli or Klebsiella, all of these, especially with increasing medical tourism, these organisms have been causing, because people go to areas which are cheaper for healthcare, and so when they go there, they are more likely to pick up these organisms and then carry it back with them. Okay, so the spread of multi-resistant strains of staph aureus as well as vancomycin-resistant enterococci is usually by transient carriage on the hands of healthcare workers. So it is the healthcare workers, because they move from patient to patient, and as they move from patient to patient, as they examine different patients, it's these organisms are found on the hands, and therefore it's very important that healthcare givers wash their hands frequently. Now all of us have been washing our hands, and we know all the things which are associated, okay, all the dry hands, okay, the dryness and the constant washing of hands, how difficult it can be. So another thing that would be to change gloves, okay, to use gloves while examination, and to change gloves, okay, while examining patients. Okay, thank you. All right, so what are the roots of spread? Excuse me, just 1 minute, please. All right, so that's taken care of, and we continue with our class. So what are the routes of spread? So as we've seen, direct contact, okay, very important. You must be reading in the news as to even when COVID has come, okay, about COVID. So first they said, oh, you know, first surfaces are more important. So clean the surfaces, because when you cough or sneeze, these are heavy particles and they will fall on the surface. Okay, and then so you need to keep that clean. They said, oh, we don't see that there's too much of, you know, spread in the air. It's more likely only within direct contact and distance, so stay far. And now you can see that they're saying, oh, there is a possibility of airborne transmission. Now, it is common sense that when you have something which is respiratory and we do not know too much, to assume that there is airborne transmission, okay? So it's quite likely when you sneeze or cough that some of those particles are going to get airborne and they're going to give you droplet infection, okay? So rather than spending time and wasting, and people are now wondering, oh, it's not like the virus is going to come jumping to you onto you, okay, through the air. It is respiratory borne, and therefore it's always better to assume, and wearing a mask makes sense, okay, for respiratory tract infections. Okay, so direct contact organisms are transferred directly from the hands of the doctor or nurse to a susceptible patient. Droplet infection through coughing or sneezing, because you're coughing with violence and force, so these particles, so it depends on the size, okay? The larger particles will drop and fall down and they'll form your droplet nuclei, and therefore when you sweep or move, these nuclei get disturbed, okay? The lighter ones will get caught in the air and travel. We know with tuberculosis that they can travel for a long distance, okay? So it is safe to assume that whenever you have respiratory tract infections, that these are also both direct as well as indirect transmission occurring, okay? So release of hospital dust into the air. Another important route of spread is hospital procedures. Catheterization, endoscopy, okay, intravenous procedures, use of infected suture materials. These are all procedures which are associated with risk, okay, of transmission of disease. Now let's look at these interests. Okay, let's look at the portals of entry. So whenever you use urinary drainage systems, so you have the urethral meatus and the catheter junction, okay? So where the catheter goes into, okay, is inserted into the urethra. So where the junction between the urethra and the catheter, that is a potential source of a tract for infection. Then also where the catheter and the drainage tube, that junction is another important source, okay? Drainage tubing, and then it goes into the bag. So the bag, the tube that goes into the bag, that junction, and at the outlet, you know, to empty the urine bag, to measure the urine output, and also to clear up, okay, because normally this urine is collected, so they at least twice a day, okay. So what sometimes they do is they put some antibiotic in the, they put an antiseptic solution in the urine bag as well, okay, and then try to clean. So how, this is one of the potential source, okay. So you can see how there has been key studies which have been done on looking to see and track to see what are the potential sources of infection when you insert a catheter into a patient. Now let's look at this is a very common thing that is carried out most times when patients are hospitalized. The first thing that is done is an IV line is taken, okay? And often this is used to give medicines and also as treatment, okay? So to rehydrate the patient. Now you can see here, you have the bottle here, okay, with the fluid, and you have the tubing, okay, and then it is inserted. You can see the insertion site, okay? Look at all the potential. This is such a simple, common, routine procedure which is carried out in the hospital. Okay, so look at the portals of entry here, okay? So the fluid itself during manufacture, if it is substandard quality, the fluid itself can be contaminated with organisms, okay? So if the manufacturer has not followed standard precautions, the fluid itself, when you put it in, can be contaminated, can cause infection, okay? So during manufacture itself. Then you can also have cracks or punctures on the bottle, which can be a source of infection. Then often what you do is, if you want to put it there, you know, you put in a stick in a needle and push it into the fluid, okay, to give. So B-complex and all these are pushed into these things, and you can see the fluid becomes yellow colored. So anything you add into the fluid can also be a source. Then many times, okay, there's a medication pot and you put it inside when you want the medicine to go slowly, okay? You want it to go it as an infusion. You don't want to give a bolus. So you just put it into the pot. That is another. So the medication pot can be a site. place where the tubing gets attached to the bottle, that is another potential site. Okay, the stopcock, the insertion site. Okay, secondary infection from the other side. All right, all of these are potential portals of entry for microorganisms in the intravenous systems. Now, Clostridium difficile. This is another infection which is commonly seen in hospital-acquired infections. So this can spread from contaminated surfaces as well as the hands of hospital staff. So you get these bacteria as well as spores. Okay, these are temporary on the hands of us, and it enters the body, and you can see it multiplies in the GIT. And then you can see this is the micro picture. Okay, if you look at the colon, you see this pseudo membrane which is formed within the colon. It releases toxins, which can damage the colon, and this leads to the formation of your pseudomembrane formation. Now, this is a very difficult infection to treat, and therefore the focus on this Clostridium difficile. So the word difficile itself means in French difficult. Okay, so that is why it has been coined as Clostridium difficile. Okay. Now, who are the recipients of hospital-acquired infections? I'm sure by now you already know. So all patients are potential recipients. Okay, anybody who comes to a hospital for admission, okay, is a potential recipient of infection. And especially those who are admitted in intensive care units, those who are in urological geriatric wards, persons who are severely ill, those who are under corticosteroid therapy are more susceptible. Okay, so as we know, okay, those who have comorbid conditions, those who are in immune suppressive therapy are more the beds also is important now, as we are seeing, because transmission of infection from one to the other. And you see, though the patients may be apart, it's the same set of doctors are moving from patient to patient. Okay, so therefore, after examining one patient, you have to take care that you clean your hand before you go to the next, because so that doctors and healthcare givers don't act as the carriers of transmission. Okay. So now we are looking at preventive measures. So it's very important that we isolate the infectious patients. Okay, so it's important that infectious patients, those having respiratory tract infections, pneumonia, okay, all of these patients should be isolated. Okay, those who are caring for them should also have barrier nurses. Okay, so they should put on all the protective layer, and you are quite familiar with us because today it has become standard practice now in hospitals. Okay, because of the increased number of COVID patients, those who are in hospital care settings are already putting on and taking a lot of care for and using protective personal equipment. Okay, another thing is hospital staff who are suffering from infectious disease should be kept away from work and patients. Now, with this was not routinely done, and this is what is forgotten. Now, we ask if any patient is going to undergo surgery. Routinely, we ask for HIV test, and we also ask for hepatitis B. But what about the surgeon who's operating? Okay, shouldn't that person also be free? Okay, so it's important that those who are not, who are operating, those who are also potential source, even healthcare givers should also have a clean chit. Okay. So if anybody is not well, they should be kept away from work, and they should be kept away from the patients. Most important preventive measure is hand washing. Okay, so thorough hand washing when dealing with patients. Now, what type of hand washing depends on where you are in the healthcare setting. So if you're seeing patients, you can do a simple hand washing, an antiseptic hand washing. If you're going to perform surgery or any invasive procedure, then you need to have a surgical scrub. So simple steps, but which need to be reinforced. Okay, so first of all, somebody was asking me about how do you open the tap and close the tap. So can you see this cloth here? So you can keep one cloth, a clean cloth, to open the tap and to close the tap after you have cleaned your hands. So that is an important way. In hospital settings, you must have seen that we also have these long swivel handles on the wash basins, which can be used. So you can use your elbow to open and close the tap. So depending on what kind of tap is there, now we don't have the swivel taps at home. So at home, you can use a clean cloth to open the tap and to close the tap. Okay, so that you don't contaminate the tap surface with your hands, and you don't, after you have washed your hands, you don't get again contaminated. Okay, so that's a simple way to wash hands. So you wet your hands, you take adequate soap. Now, simple soap is enough. Soap is very usable. Okay, so it's not necessary that you have to use only Lifebuoy or Dettol, though they would promote their product, but you can see all of them are now saying that use any soap, because any soap is very usable. Okay, so lather and scrub for at least 20 seconds. Make sure that you wash, okay, between your fingers. That you, first of all, is you scrub. Okay, when you scrub between your fingers, under your nails, and the top of your hands. Okay, and then you rinse. So you take time to rinse properly, and then you turn the tap off and dry your hands. Okay, so you can use a clean cloth to open the tap, to close the tap, and to dry your hands, which can be kept close to the sink and which can be replaced often. Another important preventive measure is to control the dust in the hospital care setting. So hospital dust is whenever you, there is sweeping, there's dusting, or the beds are made, there's a whole, okay, all of, there's a whole cloud that is released. Okay, so you can suppress that dust from rising up like a cloud by using wet dusting, or very affordable, they can even use vacuum cleaning. Okay, so it depends on the hospital care setting. You normally would not see vacuum cleaning happening in government settings, but in private healthcare settings, we charge patients. Okay, they use more fancy equipment, but wet wiping is a simple way. Okay, so you clean with a mop, you clean with a wet cloth, and that will prevent the dust from being released into the atmosphere. Disinfection. So this is an important prevention measure. So all articles which are used by the patient should be disinfected. The patient's urine should be disinfected. The patient's sputum, as well as the patient's feces, okay, should be disinfected. Then all instruments should be properly sterilized. Control of droplet infection by use of face masks, proper bed spacing, adequate ventilation and lighting. As you all know that during this COVID setting, the AC systems have been turned off, because we have now realized that these organisms can use that AC ducting to travel more fast. Okay, so AC is switched off, and instead windows are open and you allow proper ventilation and light. Okay, so sunlight is a good disinfectant, and so it's good to have proper sunlight, okay, in the room. Very important to use face masks. There are some people who find it difficult to breathe. So maybe when you're doing active work, like people, if you're at home and you're exercise gymming, you don't need to use. So at home, you don't use your mask. But when you go out, and especially in the hospital care setting, you need to protect yourself with a face mask. Nursing, very important, is because doctors spend only a little while with the patients. It's the nurses who are in more contact and prolonged contact. So it's important for nurses to have, for you to have barrier nursing and task nursing. So barrier nursing is to evolve all of your PPE, okay, today, to wear all of it, when especially for patients who are isolated, okay, those who are immunocompromised. So for them, the barrier nursing is used, and also task nursing. That means you allocate tasks. So for patients who are, you separate out the patients, okay, and you isolated the patients who are infectious, and you separate out the healthcare caregivers also. So who are allocated for the very seriously ill patients have been isolated. You don't allow them to go and mingle with the other staff, other patients who are not that well. So that is task nursing. Okay? So you want to reduce cross infection. So it's important that you have barrier nursing as well as task nursing. So administration, as you see that in hospital infection control, the administration has a very important role to play. So the hospital infection committee is the one that formulates policies on admission, okay? What type of patients you will admit, when you admit, where you're going to admit them, which ward you're going to place them, how many isolation wards you have, how many beds you have over there, okay? So which patient goes where, okay? What are the isolation facilities? What are your disinfection procedures? Whether your people are trained for that, okay? And how you're going to dispose the waste. It's very important that every healthcare setting have these basic principles, okay? Because that is the way that you're going to reduce cross-infection. That is the way you're going to reduce the incidence of hospital-acquired infections. OK, So it's very important that attention is paid to all of this. So not when the patient comes, you are thinking, now what do I do, where I put? You have to have policies in place which are written, pasted, and kept in the ward, in the emergency, kept everywhere. So people who are working and your staff should be trained to know how to use these policies and how to translate these policies into action. Okay. So policies for students may look as, oh, okay, it's some, you know, jargon and word. It's very important, because when you have this policy, then you can utilize that policy to make and function more effectively. Okay. So this is an example of barrier nursing. As you can see, this is what is all being done. Okay, where you put on apron, how you don your the PPE and how you doff, that is also important. So the order in which you wear it is also the order in which you take it off. Okay, so donning and doffing. Okay, the use of that. Now specific. Okay, what are the measures of prevention of infection? All right. Now often during you thought it was infection. Okay, and you want to prevent. You can't take a whole antibiotics and put it in your, okay, overhead water tank, and so that all patients are getting antibiotic. Okay, so that is not rational. Okay, you not that you give everybody antibiotic and you will prevent hospital acquired infection. That is not how you go about doing hospital acquired infection, right? So we have to target and know what are we going to deal with. Okay, so when you're looking at urinary tract infections, there are measures which have been proven to be effective. Limit the duration of catheter. Okay, so you put in a catheter, you have to monitor and be very careful how long your catheter is in place. You only need it for a short duration. When the patient is able to move, patient is mobile, okay, there is a pain, patient is able to pass urine, you need to take the catheter off. So limit the duration of the catheter. Use an aseptic technique at the time of insertion and maintain closed drainage. See that your, you know, the place where you open is not open. You have to maintain closed drainage so that there are no potential tract for entry of the microorganisms. Now, interestingly, if you look at what has not been proven to be effective, so if a patient has a catheter and you just put him on an antibiotic, systemic antibiotic prophylaxis is not very effective in preventing urinary tract infections, because you can have, when you're giving one antibiotic, you can have development of the, it's selective, right? So the organisms which are resistant will grow, all right? So in fact, using systemic antibiotic puts pressure and allows the growth of all antimicrobial resistant organisms. Okay, so you end up even worse. So this is better rather than using a systemic antibiotic. They've even tried bladder irrigation, installation of normal saline, antiseptic or antibiotic in the bladder. Does not work, not very effective. Antiseptic added to drainage bag is more of a symptomatic for the person to know that there is an antiseptic in the bag. Again, not very effective. Antimicrobial coated catheter also does not seem to be effective. Sometimes they've even tried cleaning, okay, daily antiseptic perineal cleaning, not very effective. So it may work for some, may not work for some, not consistent. But what is proven to be effective is limit duration of catheter, aseptic technique and insertion, and maintaining close drainage. That means you need to monitor, give care at the time and take care, because it is the portals of infection which are to be taken care of. For surgical site infections, the surgical technique is very important. Okay, the operating environment, a clean environment, staff attire with the clothes, okay, worn by the health caregivers, limiting pre-op hospital stay. So if the patient is to be operated on the bed, just admit the patient a day before for some of the investigations. Do many of your other investigations, your routine investigations, and on an OPD basis rather than admitting them. So just admit the patient on the day before surgery, okay? And keep the patient also only as long as you need, okay? So early mobilization is important. A pre-op shower, local skin preparation of patient, optimal antibiotic prophylaxis, aseptic practice in operating room, surgical wound surveillance, okay? That these are very effective. Fumigation, pre-op shaving, they are important, but not primary in preventing. So fumigator is important. If you want to have an OT, you have to fumigate it, okay? But you have to be more vigilant to more than just fumigation, you have to prevent a surgical site infection. For pneumonias, especially those are ventilator associated pneumonias, if a patient is on ventilator, you have to prevent ventilator associated pneumonia. So it's important that your tubing, okay, intubation is done in an aseptic manner, that the suctioning of fluid, that is important, that the, you know, the all the fluids, the respiratory fluids, they are suctioned well. You limit the duration of the ventilator. As far as possible, use a non-invasive ventilation. The other things that can also be done is that all staff, all healthcare givers, especially ICU, should have a flu shot. They should receive influenza vaccines. There should be a policy for isolation. Sterile water should be used for oxygen and aerosol therapy. You have to prevent Legionella and Aspergillus during renovation. So it's important that you're constantly having surveillance, that you're collecting swabs, you're watching, you're monitoring the ICU environment. Okay. Now, digestive decontamination for all patients, changing ventilator circuit every 48 or 72 hours is not as effective. So now that we've seen that antibiotic resistant organism is important, let's look at how you control this antibiotic resistance. Okay. So it's very important that we ensure the appropriate use of antibiotics. Okay. That means when we talk about rational therapeutics, what is the optimal choice? When you're prescribing an antibiotic for UTI, see that you've done a culture sensitivity test and that you're recommending an antibiotic that is sensitive. Okay, the appropriate one and not just a routine one that you're used to writing it out. So optimal choice, dosage, duration of antimicrobial therapy, chemoprophylaxis based on defined hospital antibiotic policy. So it's important to have an antibiotic policy, which is not there everywhere in settings, but this is what is recommended. Okay, monitoring and antibiotic resistance, and you have to periodically update the guidelines. Okay, so when you have an institutional antibiotic policy, then the healthcare givers know what to use and what has been found and what are the organisms. So this is based on past studies which are done in the hospital setting. Okay, so you have to institute protocols, guidelines for intensive infection control procedures, provide adequate facilities and resources, especially for hand washing, barrier precautions for patients who are isolated, as well as environmental control measures. Okay, so you can see this is, so it's just not one person or the treating physician who can prevent it. It's a whole team that has to work together to prevent hospital-acquired infections. Okay. So we have to improve antimicrobial prescribing practices through educational and administrative methods. Now, when this comes, doctors are the biggest offenders. Okay, they are the ones, the biggest culprits for antimicrobial resistance. And therefore, constant hammering for medical students about using the right antibiotics. Okay, and limit use of topical antibiotics, because we now know that if you use topical, the person can get, you can develop resistance to that antibiotic as well. So it's important that we follow standard precautions for all patients. Okay, so rather than test a patient and then take precaution, if you already have taken precaution, then you will be safe. Okay, so wash hands promptly after contact with infective material. Use no touch technique wherever possible. Wear gloves when in contact with blood, body fluids, secretions, excretions, mucous membranes, and contaminated items. Wash hands immediately after removing gloves. Okay. All sharps should be handled with extreme care. Now, especially about sharps, you should be careful is this capping. Okay, so many times when you use a sharp, okay, you remove the needle cap, okay, you've used it, and then while recapping, that is when people have got poked or pricked. Okay, so therefore, it's important if you use a sharp that you should have, you're using sharp very commonly, especially like in your immunization OPDs. We have this, okay, cutters, the needle cutter. So you put it in, you cut it, so that it's burnt, and then you dispose the blunt end. Okay, so you have to dispose sharps very carefully. You should handle them carefully. You should clean up spills of infective material promptly. You should ensure that patient care equipment, supplies, and linen which is contaminated with infected material is either discarded or disinfected or sterilized between each patient use. Do not use one patient's ill for another patient. Okay, so if it's not like it's tagged, you don't have one specific, it's not allotted to that patient. They just go to the laundry. So you have to see that they're thoroughly clean because they can be switched between patients. You have to assure appropriate waste handling. Okay, so what goes into which bin, that is important. If no washing machine is available for linen soiled with infective material, the linen can be boiled. Okay, so boiling is a good manner. It even takes care of spores. Now we have seen all measures which are used, especially related with the patient side, right? Now what is recommended for staff who work in healthcare settings? So at recruitment, immunization history, previous exposure to communicable disease, that is important. Some previous infections, varicella zoster virus, can be assessed by serological tests, a Mantoux test at baseline and also to document previous infection. It is recommended that all healthcare givers are vaccinated with hepatitis A and B and receive tetanus toxoid immunization. And this includes primary immunization followed by boosters at adequate intervals. Do not get into hyperimmunization, okay? Even for tetanus toxoid, see that your vaccine should be, your booster should be every 5 years, not every year, okay? Then you can read up about hyperimmunization, what happens when you take vaccines too frequently, okay? And then you need to have specific post-exposure policies, okay, for HIV, for hepatitis A, B, rabies. Okay, so it's important that in case, despite all of these, you have some person who has not been vaccinated, so person is susceptible and has been exposed to a patient who has hepatitis B or HIV, or has got pinprick. So we need to have post-exposure policies. What are the ways in which we are going to reduce the risk? So this here, in short, is the scope of the infection control and how we can prevent hospital-acquired infections. So we need to follow standard precautions of hand washing, barrier precaution, and sharps disposal. You need to have good sterilization. You need to have, if it supports, central sterilization and supply. So your infection control should support a central sterilization and supply unit. All special procedures have to be scanned, your cardiovascular access lines, wound care, urinary catheter, persons who are on ventilators, okay, environmental control, physical facility, patient care equipment, air, water, food, the solid waste and liquid waste disposal, housekeeping, especially linen, very important, okay, isolation precautions for those who are having communicable disease. Okay, along with that, you have to report the disease to the health authority. You have to have surveillance for resistant organisms. And you have to have preventive treatment for those who are exposed to these persons. Okay, you have to have an infection committee which has guidelines and policies which are written, which the staff know about. There's no point of just having a policy, but it's so you just have something to fulfill recommendations, but your staff are not available. So you have to have a functioning committee and functioning policies. Surveillance is a very important component of the infection control committee. So nosocomial infection, surveillance system, antibiotic sensitivity. So you can see the role which is played here by your committee. You have to have people from the microbiology department on the committee who are taking swabs from the OT, they're taking swabs from patients, they're collecting it from the ventilators, from the tubings, and going to see how we are doing, okay? And very importantly is how we take care of the health of the employees. Okay, so we have to have reporting, screening, okay, immunization policies for healthcare workers so that we reduce their exposure to communicable disease. So we have seen in a nutshell how we can, what are the different types of hospital acquired infections and how we can reduce our exposure. So it's important for you as future doctors, and also because you go to the ward as students, what precautions you should take when you go to the ward, okay, how you can reduce your exposure. And if you are not well, you're sneezing and coughing, if you have fever, don't go, okay? That is the best way you can protect yourself as well as the patient, all right? So this is all about hospital acquired infection, and with this I complete my class today. So thank you very much.